Hello again, and welcome back to the Southern Highlands. In this episode, we climb Beinn Crannach, the last and highest of the Bridge of Orkney Munros, which, if we're being obtuse, should technically be called the Beinn Crannach Group, but no one calls it that. Along the way, we'll also visit Gorton, Bothy and its fascinating social history, reforge a path through the ancient Wood of Crannach, pass through the glen of the mythical Cailleach, and explore the ancient pagan ritual site of Tigh, as well as concluding the story of hydroelectricity in Scotland as we explore the western end of Glen Lyon and its eponymous loch. This expedition takes us in a round trip around the entire Wall of Rannoch and the Bridge of Orkney range, crossing it at its highest point. Beginning once again in Bridge of Orkney, we follow the road up to Acalader and continue along Strathtula to the bridge at Barrabourick, where the walker faces two options. One, cross the bridge and follow the north bank of the water of Tulla towards Gorton and ford the river a few miles upstream to pick your way through the sparse woodland to the open hillside above, or two, don't cross the bridge and continue straight along the riverbank and up into the thickest part of the Crannach Wood to fight your way to the old railway bridge hidden in its midst. From there the path becomes increasingly indistinct and overgrown in the final section, but there are waymarkers hiding in the undergrowth. Both options are moderately annoying. With the bridge over the river down, there's simply no easy way to reach this Munro that doesn't involve a bit of hassle. However, to help you decide, we'll take both paths. You'll see what I mean. Once the Crannach Wood has been defeated, it's a relief to be on the open hillside with, weather permitting, a clear view of the route all the way up to the summit ridge. The Alta Cuirlochan tumbles its way past you over the picturesque granite pavements and under lonely Scots pines, making the gradual but steady ascent to Cuirlochan a delight in good weather, with the increasingly formidable views to the north adding an epic background to proceedings. Shortly before the lip of the corrie is reached, the path crosses the stream and peters out, leaving you to force a line over the tussocks to the obvious scree scar that leads to the east shoulder between Beinn Crannach and Point 961. From here the views open up to, in mountaineering jargon, 100% wowzers. The summit ridge lies tantalisingly 100 metres above, close enough to see the rocks of the cairn, but between you and it lies the northeast ridge, a gnarly arete with a near vertical drop into Cuirlochan on its north edge, and to the south, a very steep plunge down into the Lochan at the base of the deep Cuir du Feig, little dark corrie, but there's not much little about it as we'll see. Beware, if you don't have a head for height, this section could potentially be rather unnerving in poor weather. There's no actual exposure, but the narrowness and rough, steeper terrain of the upper ridge may prove an unpleasant sting in the tail for some. For most Munroists, however, this airy final pull to the summit ridge will be a delight. The views in all directions are superb, and the dizzying sight of Loch Lyon and the rock amphitheatre suddenly far below an added thrill. On reaching the summit ridge, an easy slope to the high summit rewards you with, appropriately, the best views in the Bridge of Orkney group. The standard descent route is back the way that you came up, or, if you're feeling adventurous, along the walls of Beinn Acalader, eventually descending to Acalader via Cuir Dingin. However, there's more to this wonderfully remote area than just the Munros. From the east shoulder, we eschew a rematch with the Crannach Wood to venture forth down pathless slopes into wild Glen Cailleach, site of Tigh, Bodach, perhaps the oldest surviving pagan ritual in Europe, and associated with the mythical Cailleach. We then make a return to Glen Lyon, following the bank of Loch Lyon to traverse around Beinn Vannach, and enter the Och Glen via Strathtraven, before traversing around the base of Beinn Doran via Och Farm, and up the West Highland Way back to Bridge of Orkney.
Yeah.
Well, here we are approaching Barrabourick and the bridge over the water of Tulla. And down here at the bridge, you've got a couple of choices. You can either head over the bridge and along the track, just round the corner there. We'll be heading up over either a very rickety or a completely broken footbridge that supposedly has been replaced with stepping stones. So we're going to go and have a look at that just now and save ourselves an unpleasant surprise next time. Probably when we do the summit, we'll ascend through the Wood of Crannach here, which I imagine is very boggy, so we're going to skip that experience, I think. Yeah, sadly our winter attempt on the hill was scuppered by 80 mile an hour gusts and heavy snow, but it gave us a chance to visit Gorton Bothy at the far end of Strath Tulla, with its tremendous, definitive views of the Great Wall of Rannoch. Hugging the river, the track gained some height and drops it again before the cairn to the broken footbridge some 2 kilometres from Barrabourick. Beyond here, the track continues over the Bruach Rue before dropping slightly for another 3.5 kilometres to rise again, obscuring the potentially very welcome Bothy until you're almost right on top of it. Now, the bothy will never be locked unless there's maintenance going on and they don't want you in there.
Who lives in a house like this? Well,
me,
potentially, because this looks like a pretty nice bothy.
Toilet procedure. And this is your toilet assistant. Again, common sense rules regarding toileting. Don't do it anywhere near the bothy and bury it when you're done. This is a lobby. Now, you'll notice that there's quite a lot of doors going on in here. That's mainly to insulate against the cold, to keep as much of the wind out as we can. Have a look in here. Yep, this is what you should be expecting coming into a bothy. But this is what you're coming in for, of course. Let's go and have a look in the east wing. Oh, wow, look at that. There is a hearth. Hearth for a fire there, so you can get a nice fire going in. There's a nice little collection of utensils here. And of course this is the bothy book that you'll be filling in and leaving your stories in here. Some lovely messages here from both the people who maintain it and of course visitors from all over the globe. So yeah, this is a really nice bothy and I'm just going to chill here. There's even a padded seat. This is pretty much unheard of in the Munro travels so far.
Gorton was a stopover on the ancient Rannoch drove road to Glen Lyon, and as with the now demolished railway station about a mile to the southeast, it takes its name from the 502-metre Mela Gorton that rises behind it. Up until the 1960s, Gorton was a shepherd's lodging, which relied on the tiny, remote station at Gorton Crossing for most contact with the outside world. The station was private at the landowner's behest, and comprised of little more than a passing place and a platform, upon which a railway carriage was placed to serve as a school for the children of the disparate Rannoch and Glen Orkey communities. While a stay at the bothy may be a fun experience for we who visit, life at Gorton was hard, especially in winter, as former resident John Brown explains. My father was a shepherd. At age 6, I moved to a wee house with my parents, which is now Gorton Bothy. A wooden footbridge was built over the river, so I could follow the railway line to school. Though I didn't understand it properly at the time, life was tough on my folks. Being ill was not an option. During lambing and gathering times, my father put in some very long days, his work taking him variously towards Loch Lyon, Rannoch Station, and also onto Beinn Cailleach and Beinn Caillder. He would be away from home before 6 a.m. to return around 9 p.m. during busy spells. My mother had to travel to Fort William to have all her teeth replaced with dentures. Even the journey to Fort William would have been a nerve-wracking experience. We were allowed to keep one cow and one follower, a calf, which would be sold as a yearling. There were also hens, usually three hard-worked collies, and most of the time a garran, a Highland pony, grazed around the house too. At the rear of the house was a small hayfield, and our water was carried from a wee burn there. Sometimes we got a cart of coal delivered, but relied mostly on peat, which was cut to the east of the house. Wood was very scarce. Our fuel supply was supplemented as we exchanged homemade butter, eggs and milk with the goods train crews for coal. They slowed down to receive our items and flung off large lumps of coal, which were then brought home on a slipe, a sheet of corrugated iron, pulled by the pony. Today Gorton is a splendid example of a well-maintained bothy, and clearly a lot of love and hard work goes into its upkeep. For more on the hidden world of bothying, check out the Mountain Bothies Association website and have a look in your local library or bookshop for the Bothy Bible.
Hello again. Here we are, as you can tell, in much more temperate climes. We're back at Baravurik Bridge, and this time we're going to take the right-hand turn, going to stay on this side of the river and head up through the Wood of Crannach, up there to the Corrie, and Loch in a Crechin. This looks promising, doesn't it? Vista back down the Loch Tulla, and we're going to continue into the jungle. Well, here we are, making our way through arboreal wonderland here. It's a nice bit of respite from the hot sun.
The ancient pine wood of Crannach has long been designated a site of special scientific interest due to its Arctic alpine habitat. Its majestic Scots pines tower above a unique variety of invertebrate life, with alpine flowers to be found on the higher slopes, along with many birds and wildlife. As protected woodland, it has become a verdant mixture of the old and the new, with younger mixed trees like birch, larch, oak and rowan rubbing branches with older, far taller trees in a highly photogenic menagerie.
Well, it's all getting a bit choose your own adventure up here, but there's worse places to be tramping through without a path, to be honest.
The cuckoo agrees.
And as you can see, this is pretty much what we're making our way through here. Very pleasant indeed. Well, we've finally found what remains a very slight path up here to the railway bridge. Woods that we've come through here, beautiful mixed woodland. Not so easy underfoot, and I'm very glad that we didn't try this in the winter time, because it would have been hellish, hellish bog, but beautiful today, and we're finally getting some height as well. We're going to cross over the railway, finally onto the hillside. And there it is, the railway bridge up there. Unlike the bridge over the river down there, this railway bridge here is in full working order. Looking down the West Highland line there, and up towards Gorton Crossing and Rannoch. This is our path, a telltale style. So yeah, let's keep moving. Okay, so once you're over the railway bridge, these way markers keep you right. We are getting some height now, starting to see back down the floodplain to Loch Tulla, the magnificent Crannach woods that we're in the midst of right now. here we are just about approaching final deer fence style, and we're going to start making our direct ascent towards the corrie. Okay, so this last bit of pass here is pretty overgrown, and getting a few scratches off these branches, I've got to say. But hopefully soon we'll emerge from the forest, more like a jungle, and find ourselves on the open hillside. Soon, hopefully. As you can see, I am on the path, in case you were wondering. It's just, as I say, extremely overgrown. And beginning to test the patience a little bit, so hopefully we'll be out of it soonish. Yes! Finally escaped from that Wood of Crannach. And we're rewarded here. This magnificent panorama. Beinn a Cailleach there behind me. The amphitheatre up there of Beinn a Cailleach and Cúran Lochan. Can't beat the beautiful Scots pine to frame these mountain vistas.
Yes, it's time for that section of the show where we test out interesting items of clothing and equipment on the Munros so that you don't have to. This time we look at the holy grail of drinking water solutions for the weight-conscious mountaineer, the MSR TrailBase Water Filter Kit. The highly, highly detailed instruction sheet makes it seem more complicated than it actually is. Basically, it's two strong ultralight reservoirs, a tube and a hand-operated pump filter unit. The assembled system utilises gravity to produce drinkable water. One bag is filled with dirty water, which, when hung above the ground on, for example, a walking pole, runs through the filter to the other reservoir at ground level, producing 2 litres of clean water. Why is this a thing? Well, as anyone who's climbed in summer knows, water is usually the heaviest thing in your pack. There comes a point when, having saved weight by upgrading to lighter equipment, adding extra kilos of water becomes somewhat frustrating. That's where a water filter comes in. With the MSR TrailBase kit, you don't actually need to carry a drop of water. Unless you're heading to the desert, your drinking water is already on location. Not just high streams on the mountain, anywhere. The antimicrobial filter is designed to eliminate 99.9999% of bacteria such as E. coli and Salmonella, 99.99% of protozoa like Giardia or Cryptosporidium, and any particulate matter captured in the tube. The system is designed to cover all bases. The clean reservoir can be used as your water bottle, while the filter itself, the trail unit, can be used independently, allowing you to drink straight from any water source you come across. A few squeezes on the pump provide safe water. In reality, if you're travelling alpine style, you'll have all the components with you at all times, but the filter unit alone is the uber minimalist option for the trail runner. When approaching or returning to your camp, you can fill the dirty water bag and, when at your tent, use the gravity system for the night's drinking and cooking water. With a flow rate of 1 litre per minute, you'll have 2 litres of fresh water before you've even taken your kettle out. The whole system, when empty, weighs only 472 grams and packs down nicely into its stuff sack for ease of stowage. Was I hospitalised with food poisoning? Let's find out. The system just works. There isn't much more to say than that. It's light, it's super useful, it's well designed and manufactured, and it'll make you wonder why it took you so long to get one.
The packability is well thought out, and its flow rate is a godsend for the impatient. The trail unit is easy to use, with a few squeezes of the pump bringing you that cold spring water, minus the nasties. It's also not cheap, but if you're out on the hills a lot, given its quality and how much you'll be using it, it's £100 well spent. So if you're a regular mountain goer or backpacker, and want to save weight and your effort for the journey, the MSR TrailBase water filter kit comes highly recommended.
Well, it's another beautiful day in the neighbourhood. And as you can see from the hillside, the way markers continue to guide us up towards what is now an obvious path up there onto the shoulder and then westward up towards the summit cone. Now, some guidebooks will say that the path is on the other side of the burn here. It's 6 to 1.5 a dozen to the other, really, it doesn't matter. This side's waymarked, so we might as well follow it. Let's get on up there. Well, here we are on the steeper section that's leading up to the lip of the corrie here. See this dramatic ravine, and behind me, Rannoch Moor is beginning to appear. A lot more beside. Cailleach Moor, mouth of Glencoe there. But yeah, for now, let's go up to this corrie. I'll see you up there. Okay, so we've crossed over the stream, and behind me there you can see the imposing gargantuan walls there of the Cur an Lochan. We're basically heading directly for that scar on the hillside there, which denotes the path. 0.961 here, subsidiary top, and we're heading for the Bialik in between, on the shoulder, up there. And then following the skyline up to the highest point you can see there, behind which lies the summit cone itself. Now this is still in the Southern Highlands, just. As I mentioned last time, Bridge of Orkney Hills are quite a different prospect to the rest of the Southern Highlands, with the exception of possibly Beinn Lewy. But this terrain here is very much indicative of what we're going to find in series 2 when we visit the Central Highlands. As you can see, it's all a bit more serious. Luckily the cloud cover has kind of come over and blocking the sun out a bit, so it's a bit cooler, thank goodness, for this hard part here. But once we're up on the ridge, we're just going to follow that arête up there to the high point and the summit. Let's get cracking. I'll see you up on the ridge. Okay, just over there, I've got a first view of the summit. There it is. The going looks good. Well, here we are, finally emerging onto the top of the ridge, and I must say, what a view! Wow. This magnificent amphitheatre is but the entrance lobby to the mountain itself. Of course, the summit is at the top of this ridge here. It looks nice and airy. Looking over there to Glencoe, the mouth of Glencoe, and Cailleach Moor. Of course, the beast and Rannoch Moor, this expanse out here. Looking over there to Beinn Nevis, which is nice and clear, you can see, in Tarn Morgerach, the Aenix, the grey corries, black corries, and the fantastic hills of Glenateeve there as well. Absolutely magnificent vista here down to the South Highlands. We're getting Beinn Moor and Stovinion. Beinn his Garnock there. You can see that nasty pull up Strontair we had to do. There, the Lors Range there, you can see. Over there is Shehalion. And just to its right there, the hills, the Carn Madoc group, the Glen Lyon Horseshoe. To the left of Shehalion there is Miel Buia, which we did last summer, with that astonishing panorama at the top. And there on the other side of Lochan Das is Stucan Lochan. And you can see Miel Garav and An Stuc there in silhouette, looking quite dramatic. Looking down, you can see Beinn Vorlich of Loch Earn and Stucker Croin as well, looking very nice. And of course, Miel Gurdy and the Ptarmigan Ridge behind it in silhouette. Beautiful Loch Lyon down here, and the rather resplendent Beinn Achrechion. Outstanding. Let's head on up there.
So safety note, the northeast ridge may appear to be pretty tame in this episode, but when winter hits, it can become a whiteout on a snowy knife edge, blasted by 70 mile an hour gales and lined with cornices, thus a very dangerous route, only to be undertaken by winter experienced Munroists with strong mountain sense.
Just down here, that tiny little black speck, you can see Gorton Bothy.
Well, the ridge isn't too bad so far. Nearly at the steep bit here, and the summit beckons.
Well, here we are, finally up on the summit ridge itself. Not far to go now. Atoll. Outrageous panoramas today. Wow, look at that, and the peaks of Glencoe rising above patchwork quilt that is Rannoch Moor and its many and varied lochs. The field of the hard water down there. As you can see, there's a hell of a lot of snow on this lee slope here. It gives you an idea of what it would have been like in the winter time, and to be quite honest, on a serious note, I'm very glad that I didn't even attempt to come up here, because, well, if I had, it would have been extremely dangerous up here, especially on that ridge there. In not much visibility, this is a pretty dangerous place to be. In the winter time, if you're coming up here, make sure that you know what you're doing, you're very experienced, you've got ice axe, crampons, and know how to use them.
Well, after nearly 6 months of waiting, finally make it to the highest point, the Wall of Rannoch, Bridge of Orkney Range.
Beinn Achrechion, at 1,081 metres, the Hill of the Clamshell. Now, meaty cairn, as you can see. And, some meaty views, which I'll let you feast your eyes on. make out another Munro enthusiast making their way along the summit ridge there, enjoying these absolutely fantastic conditions we've got today. Perfect blend of blazing sunshine and nice cooling cloud cover. This is our route, a meandering path there, winding its way around the eastern arm, the eastern flank of Beinn Rannoch there. And we're going to traverse Beinn Rannoch back to Aisne Sain, back through the Auk Glen.
Glen Cailleach is a hanging valley below the south face of Beinn Crechion and Beinn Rannoch's rocky northern facade. Its name bears reference to the ancient Celtic spirit of winter and storms, the Cailleach. Cailleach is derived from the Irish Gaelic Cailleach, Veiled One. The Veiled One was a creator deity that shaped much of the known landscape, though this seems to have been an unintentional act. Her tools of creation and destruction included her hammer, with which she was able to control storms and thunder, and a great well that could overflow and flood the land. A pagan creator, fertility and ancestor goddess, the Cailleach isn't a classical deity as we understand it. Here in Scotland, the term Cailleach meant storm hag. The legend refers instead to the spirit of the landscape, anthropomorphised into a powerful but crotchety old lady. You wouldn't miss her. She had one eye, red teeth, pale blue skin, and her clothes were adorned with skulls, which were unlikely to have been a mere fashion statement. She was also known variously as the Divine Hag, the Hag of Vara, or the rather more flattering Queen of Winter. Associated with the primal forces of creation and destruction, her powers were apparently limitless, lifting mountains, forging rivers, summoning storms, gouging locks and, as Queen of Winter, holding the power over whether crops lived or died. She was said to have created Loch Lyon and Loch Tigh, the latter when she forgot to replace the flagstone on top of her well. I suppose it's easily done. She cared strongly for animals, both wild and domestic, during the dark winter months. She was the patron of wolves, emboldened by winter hunger, and also served as a deer herder, though exactly why an omnipotent being would need to herd deer, and indeed for whom, remains unclear. Like nature itself, the Cailleach is neither good nor evil. She simply is. In Irish and Manx tradition, her reputation is fearsome, but although strange and terrible things are said to occur if anyone messes with the crops in her glen, the Cailleach of this area is more benign. According to legend, the Cailleach, the Bodach and their children appeared to the people of Glen Lyon and Glen Cailleach seeking shelter. Despite their fearsome reputations, or perhaps because of them, the family were granted shelter. During this period, the surrounding glens became incredibly fertile. Before departing the area, the Cailleach gave the people a parting gift. The area would be eternally fertile, provided that they put up stones for her family between May the 1st and October the 31st, from Beltane to Samhain. Each year, this ritual is repeated. Tigh na Bodach is her shrine on the map, though it should really be called Tigh na Cailleach. The shrine is made up of a modest stone structure that houses a family of bell-shaped water stones from the riverbed of the Lyon. The largest represents the Cailleach, the old woman, accompanied by the Bodach, old man, and their daughter, Nian. The Tigh na Bodach is recognised as the oldest uninterrupted pagan ritual in Britain, some say in all of Europe. For centuries, the family of stones have been taken out of their house every spring and placed facing down the glen. At the beginning of November, they're carefully shut back up inside the house, where they shelter throughout the winter. The ritual coincides with the two great Celtic fire festivals, Beltane and Samhain, which once echoed the annual migrations of cattle and their herders to and from the summer shealings, such as those we looked at Loch and Daff back in episode 19. The shealings here in Glenmuirin may be long abandoned, but the practice of tending to the stones is still observed to this day. Residents and other visitors who know of the stones also walk into the site throughout the year. The Tynan Bodach is a unique part of Glen Lyon's heritage, and an unbroken connection to its Celtic ancestors. A recent renovation of the house restored the stone structure and the rotten roof, ensuring that, sheltered from the modern world by the Great Wall of Rannoch, this indomitable little family have a sturdy bothy of their own for many winters to come.
Well, here we are, having come over the wall when Cailleach there and the beast that is Beinn a Cruachan, resplendent in beautiful hazy evening sunshine. Right, now we're heading back into Glen Lyon to explore the final quarter.
Previously, we've looked at the history of how Tom Johnson and the Nosheb brought the power of hydroelectricity to the Highlands, with a progressive social clause that aimed to address the poverty of the remote communities by encouraging industry and job creators to take advantage of the new energy supply. Over 60 hydro stations were built in the 1950s and 60s, and many distant glens were connected to the national grid for the first time. In this concluding section, we look at the fall of the Nosheb and the resurgence of interest in hydroelectricity as a renewable resource in the 21st century. The aims of the social clause were ultimately unrealised. Industry did not decide to relocate to the Highlands, and this was no surprise to many, including the board's first chair, Lord Airlie, who had prophetically warned in the early days, "Do not let anybody think that the Highlands are going to become repopulated and revived by an influx of generating stations. This is wholly false. Industry on a heavy scale would never come to the Highlands because it is common sense that it is easier to bring current to industry than it is to bring industry to current." As for the development plan itself, by now its opponents had grown more powerful, and the Conservative government at the time had more interest in nuclear power and arguably its rich backers in the coal industry. The Mackenzie report was basically a moratorium on the construction of new hydro schemes, and the incoming Labour government of Harold Wilson only kept the Nosheb on life support. The fatal blow, however, was dealt not by the masked opponents of hydropower, but from the hand that fed it, nature itself. In 1955, there was a serious drought in the Highlands, which meant the Nosheb had a vastly reduced amount of current from hydroelectricity and a lot of expectant people who needed far more than they could supply. In desperation, additional current was generated from thermal plants at Dundee and Carolina Port, but this drove up prices for the consumers. Here, the social clause went from a noble and inspirational ideal to a fatally undermining constriction. Because the clause required customers all over Scotland to pay the same price regardless of their location, i.e. how much it cost in real terms to supply them, many felt that customers in urban areas were effectively subsidising the supply of those in the far remote regions of Scotland. This was not just an issue at the public, but at the industrial level. Those companies dealing with the Nosheb cried foul at the extra outlay required to receive what was effectively a less reliable current than traditional or nuclear energy. This fatally undermined the argument for further hydroelectric development, and Cruachan would be the last Nosheb project. In the 1980s, the electricity industry was privatised, and the board was formally dissolved, with Scottish Hydroelectric PLC inheriting its assets. This in turn became part of the Scottish and Southern Energy Group, whose livery adorns hydroelectric infrastructure today. Following the Kyoto Treaty, progressive governments worldwide worked to reduce carbon emissions through innovative new ways of producing energy, and some not so new. The Scottish Parliament began investment in environmentally friendly electricity generation, with the target of generating 40% of Scotland's energy supply through renewable sources of energy such as wind, sea and hydropower by 2020. New hydroelectric schemes were built at Cailleach in 2002 and Kingairloch in 2005. A comprehensive refurbishment of the Scottish hydroelectric stations has added decades more life to the existing infrastructure. The battle waged by Tom Johnson in 1943 was eventually won. Hydroelectricity in Scotland is here to stay. However, without the social clause, even more controversy surrounds hydroelectric development in the contemporary era, as the recent decision by the Highland Council to approve the construction of 7 run-of-river schemes in Glenateeve has shown. In this case, there is a concern over private profiteering at the expense of an unspoiled area of outstanding beauty. 3 of the proposed schemes on the east side of the Glen are seen as particularly intrusive and unnecessary. As with so many public services today, hydropower is no longer a social but a capitalist enterprise, which makes it a lot harder to celebrate than during the golden age of the no-sheb. In the late 2000s, planning permission was lodged for 4 run-of-river hydroelectric schemes that would have transformed Glen Cailleach and the surrounding landscape. Existing tracks would have been upgraded to take heavy traffic, powerhouses would have been constructed, burrow pits dug, and fresh tracks carved into the steeply sided slopes to weirs. An overhead power line would have run past the Tigh and Bodach and down the side of Loch Lyon. Eventually, this project was abandoned, though the apprehension of those who cared for the area at the time is echoed throughout the Highlands whenever modernity threatens to encroach. And what will become of the Tigh and Bodach? No doubt some archaeologist in Perth or Edinburgh will earn his or her salary by insisting that the stones aren't touched. The shrine will be cordoned off with a strip of high-vis tape while the diggers work the surrounding ground. What the planners are unlikely to appreciate for all their cleverly worded mitigation measures is that the Cailleach represents the whole landscape. Of course, these run-of-river schemes have their benefits. They generate much-needed renewable energy to help tackle climate change. They are far less visually intrusive than vast onshore wind farms. They often help support cash-strapped estates at times of financial uncertainty. But for all the positives, I'm still convinced that a few of our wildest places should be kept free of industrial development. Surely Glen Cailleach, with its unbroken link to our deep past, is one of them. Having seen the wild, unspoiled beauty of the area firsthand, it's hard to disagree. Over the rest of the series, we'll look at other hydroelectric schemes around Scotland firsthand. But for more information, be sure to check out Scottish and Southern Electricity's booklet Power from the Glens, Emma Wood's The Hydro Boys, Patrick Campbell's Tunnel Tigers, or drop into the visitor centre at Pitlochry Dam. From the hydro inlet at Strathtarravan, we return to Bridge of Orkney via the Auk Glen and the West Highland Way. The Auk Glen is explored in episode 20, Hard Water Part 1. Check it out if you'd like to know more about the social history of this well-trodden valley.
That's all for now. Thanks again for watching. I hope you've enjoyed this video. If you have, feel free to like, share or comment. I'll see you next time for the final episode of Series 1, The Queen of the Southern Highlands, Beinn. Till then, enjoy your adventures.